ever. Not so. Of course we beat the Germans. But not alone. So the whole issue was, who could we gang up with beating the Germans? And there, of course, the idea was the three big powers of Europe, Russia, the Brits, and the French. And they were all of them in the 20th century Europe, as you know, at war with Germany in various configurations. And they were all holding out to Denmark the prospect of alliances that would eventually give us what was ours since long time, the borderlands in which the Germans, and so on and so forth. So the peasants were utterly against this perception. And they basically felt that any notion that we would arm against Germany would just lead to another war and another defeat. Whereas the conservatives felt that a nation that is not willing to defend itself, that is not willing to defend its own border, is no nation, cannot be a country. And how can you let people who are not even in a position to defend the country govern the country? How can you let peasants, uneducated and unwilling to defend the country, get access to power? And of course, we can't. So this became a major issue. And when these peasants got power in the beginning of the 20th century, it was by compromising at this point and saying, we will defend the country, of course, but not before. And that became the Venstre position. It became a position of a pragmatic approach to the military, but also a very strong insistence that military was under civilian control, that it was the politicians setting out the terms of the Danish military policy, not the military. But even so, the compromise were distilling out a very small fragment of Venstre called the Radical Liberals, which is a contradiction in terms. Any Danish party name is a contradiction in terms. Venstre is conservative, the left is to the right, the radical liberals are in the middle, the socialists are liberal, and it goes on like that. Don't try to understand it, it's all very confused. But it has its roots in this period. So the liberals were a fraction of the peasants, and they broke out on this very issue of the defense. And they said, we have to understand and be open about the fact that a country like Denmark cannot and should not have the illusion of defending itself. Yes, if we are talking about bandits trying to cross the border, we can of course have a military that will defeat them. But any country in the world attacking Denmark will win. So we better realize that position and follow a policy that is in cohesion with the reality, rather than keep on fooling ourselves that we can actually conduct a strong military presence. So that became a major issue in Danish politics, and kept being so, because as we discussed this issue, of course, a world war was breaking out, First World War, and the issue of Denmark's position in that war was crucial. And throughout the war, just before the war, the little radical party, radical liberal party in the middle, formed a government against Venstre, their own brothers in arms 10 years before, formed a government on the basis of the socialist mandates, the mandates of the social democratic. Now the workers were so many that together with this little party they could form the basis of government. But the Socialist Democrats said, we will not take power until we are ready, even if we have the biggest party. And we will not take power and govern the country before we have the absolute majority of the parliament. So they were actually pushing this Liberal Party in the front, and it created the smallest government in Danish history just before the Second World War. It was the smallest government, but as it said itself, we may be smaller, but we are more clever than anybody else. And they were all professors and stuff, and they actually governed the country during the war. And they maintained neutrality. Denmark was not part of the First World War, but trading with both sides. And this little government built a very strong alliance with the labor movement, with the Social Democrats. And after the war, when the issue of the borders, the post-war borders in Versailles became the main issue, this little government said, we, Denmark, should not now take back a piece of Germany. We should establish a border based on a referendum in the borderlands. So we make a new border with Germany, the first not made after a war or based on the result of a war, and this border has to reflect the majorities in the borderland. Because in any borderland you have the problem that wherever you draw the border, there will be minorities north of the border, on one side of the border wanting to be on the other side, and another minority on the other side wanting to be on the first side. We have the same situation. But this border, based on a referendum, was the only border in Europe established with a referendum, and the only border that lasted even throughout the Second World War, and is still there. So it winding itself like this across the flat lands of southern Jutland. And one of the reasons why many didn't like the border was not only that many felt that we should take back more, but also that it was completely impossible to defend should there ever be a new war. And for the Radical Party, that was exactly the point. We didn't want to establish a border that could be defended. We wanted to establish a border based on the will of the people who live in the border. That diffused 500 years ago war dispute. In 1924, after the war, after the Versailles, after the big political struggle around the border, the Social Democrats for the first time established a government. And it turned out that they were not really that revolutionary, they were not really out to overturn society. It turned out that they were actually capable of governing the country. It didn't last long ago, but their leader, Mr. Stalin, the longest sitting Danish prime minister, who was a trade unionist, turned out to be also a very, very strong defendant of democracy. He coined the frame, call us social democrats, but do emphasize the last part of the word, social democrats. So he became, and the party became, a very, very strong adversary of the Bolsheviks and of the early communist movement in Denmark and throughout the world. When in Germany, when first in Russia, the Bolsheviks took over, and then in Italy, the fascists, 22, there was a big concern in Denmark about what was going to happen with democracies, as they seemed to be not able to uphold themselves. And that, of course, was proven right when the Nazis took over in Germany in 1933. And one of the most striking things in Danish politics in the 20th century was the analysis and the policies of the Danish Democratic parties facing Nazism in Germany. They realized in the early 30s exactly what they were up against. They also formulated a policy of surviving the threat, despite the fact that there was no way we could arm against Germany. And the conclusion of the politicians in the 30s was, we cannot defend ourselves in a military sense if the Germans attack. Let's lay low, let's not provoke them, meaning that Denmark was very, very low-lying in the rhetorics against the fascists and the Nazis, but there was a very strong mobilization politically around the core values of democracy. And the idea was, the fewer in the people who did not feel they belonged to society, the smaller the threat. Or as they formulated it, the threat is not primarily coming from the Bolsheviks, the fascists, and the Nazis in Russia, Italy, and Germany. That's an outside threat. The real threat is if we start to think like them, if we begin to be communists, fascists, and Nazis. So democracy has to defend itself by including as many in society as possible. And that big recognition of the role of inclusion was of course rooted in the fact that the workers had just experienced being included. The peasants before them had experienced being included. And they were able to actually include the vast majority of Danes, leading to a situation where less than 2% voted communists and little more than 2% voted Nazis. More than 90% of the electorates in the 30s and in the 40s supported the Four Democratic Party. So the support within society for totalitarian ideas was very small. It was small in the 30s. It was small when Denmark was occupied by Germany in April 1940, 75 years ago. It remained small during the occupation, where the four political parties rallying around democracy maintained power within the Danish society, excluding the Nazis from being part of power, and it was equally strong after the liberation. We still have a very, very vigorous debate in Denmark whether you can defend today not defending the country against the attack of Nazi Germany. We still have a debate whether we cooperated too much with the occupying power. We still have a debate whether we should have been fighting, but the strategy at the time was not to fight Germany, but to protect democracy. And in that, on that terms, we succeeded. After the war, the strategy of the Social Democrats, now being by far the biggest party, led from the beginning of the 30s and right up to the war by Mr. Stalin, by the Social Democrats, in coalition with the small liberal party. The strategy was, after the war, build more society, build more solidarity, create more wealth. The struggle, the Social Democrats would argue, the struggle is not about the distribution of wealth. The struggle is not about being jealous about somebody being rich. The struggle is against poverty, and especially it's about creating more wealth, about the new, as they call it, the new economic philosophy. We can create more wealth. And it turned out in the 50s and the 60s that indeed they could create more wealth. And we got into this tremendous growth track together with the rest of Western Europe and North America in the 60s and 70s. By that time, a third big group, after the peasants and after the farmers, began to let themselves be heard. A third group that felt unprivileged and not part of power. And of course, those in power knew that they could not get part of power because they were women, they were sterile, they were uneducated, they were not capable of taking responsibility, and they didn't have the skills and the knowledge, not the capacity, to be part of power. The women at this point in time felt utterly excluded from mainstream society, and they revolted in a very systematic way, following a strategy that to a large extent was inspired by what the peasants did 50 years before and the 80 years before and the workers 50 years before. Educating, insisting in being part of knowledge, insisting in not only being part of modern and productive society, but entering society at all levels and in all levels of responsibility. And once again,